This week's episode is proudly sponsored by Texas Roadhouse, where there's legendary food with legendary service.
It's kind of the equivalent of like opening your window and sticking your head out and just yelling, "What happened this week?"
What the podcast?
What the podcast?
Yeah, that's true.
Welcome back. I'm Ryan.
I'm John.
Together, we are
Ryan and John.
And on the couch, as always, Cara Tafoya, and joining us again.
Which one is the applause?
The lovely.
Oh, okay, no. Sorry.
You?
The good looking, the really fun to be around. Oh, Annie the Scove Scoveman!
Oh my gosh.
Okay, that was
okay, we're firing the sound effects guy.
Sorry.
Oh, welcome back.
A long cricket.
I want to rip right into it, Annie. Yeah. And as we welcome you back, I need from you your top five from Europe.
You know what I was thinking about today?
Yep.
I was thinking about Europe. And I was thinking about
I'm sure
how,
you have.
Yep.
I think about Europe quite a bit.
I was like thinking about how this sounds so depressing. Memories are so fleeting. And what I've realized is like
it is depressing.
How you retell the story, like right when you get back. I'm
who
sorry,
lives,
I feel
dies.
Like my mic is so low.
Who tells your story?
Right when you get back, like how you tell the story is how you're going to remember it. Mm. So like what you focus on, like, because there's already things where I literally had to like lay in bed this morning. I was like, remember the rest. Like what was it like seeing,
yeah,
like, you know, walking through Florence and like Como and all, you know, all the things, like what was the feelings? What were the things that, mm-hmm, I was just like staring at? And I had to like force myself to like keep those in my memory because I don't want the things for me to remember to be like, you know, my friends being drunk on the street and like wrangling.
Yeah. Whoa.
Clubs.
Those are kind of the best memories, aren't they?
Not all the time.
I think
maybe in the future.
I think I'd rebut that and say, I think memories aren't as fleeting. I think really strong memories last a long time. Like,
okay,
and to what you're saying, like the
you
way you felt,
memories,
the way you felt in that, like, I feel like persists through everything. Cause like I saw a TikTok about this, like, and it was a guy talking about like a breakup he had a long time ago and how now it's like he can talk about it freely because it's like, well, the details you kind of like gloss over.
Yeah.
You don't really like go there the same way. Whereas if, you know, like if you went through a breakup right now,
it'd
it's like
yeah,
you do the whole process of like, oh my gosh,
absolutely,
he said this and here's who I called. Mm. I went here and I felt like this. Wherein you can look back and go like, oh, it just didn't work out, you know? But
yeah. But Europe.
Europe.
So I went to five different countries.
Let's not lose
Europe.
The thread here.
Yeah, I don't lose the thread. Please.
Top five,
yeah,
from Europe,
top
Annie.
Top five. Oh, ah, ah.
Top five moments, top five meals that you ate.
Okay, best meal I had, and this is controversial.
Uh-huh. Whoa.
Best meal I had was the very first night of our trip. We went to Athens. We were staying in this like 4-room hotel. It was like this little like hotel that was like built in between two other buildings, this tiny thing.
Awesome.
We took this really sketchy elevator to the top floor, like, and I've never seen an elevator like this, where the doors, like that whole section of where the door would be, stays open.
Okay.
And it's the wall, like the individual doors are built into each floor. So you like open them, but it doesn't move with the elevator. And you just see like,
whoa,
the walls passing past you.
Like a bougie penthouse.
Oh,
like,
wow.
Like, you know how you like.
Like a bougie penthouse.
But normally penthouse, like even then it's like elevator door.
Yeah,
uh-huh,
it was
regular door.
But it was like the and it was literally big enough for two people. Like, no, there's no three people could fit, like two people max. And honestly, like, it was amazing. It was so sketchy, but like nice, but like just the right amount of like, ah.
But like, you got off the plane in Athens.
Oh, okay, yeah.
You went to this hotel.
Went to this hotel. We asked them where to eat. They gave us a recommendation. That place looked gross.
Okay.
and so we just like found this random place, and it was the best risotto I've had in my life. And then it kicked me off,
whoa,
on trying to order any risotto I saw. Because then I was like, turns out I love risotto.
Is risotto
cheese
just
and
like
rice.
Creamy rice?
It's just creamy rice.
Yeah. Creamy rice.
But it's so much more than that.
And then we like
isn't
go to
it?
This, we go
isn't
to
it?
This, we go to Verona in,
uh-huh,
Italy, which is like known for risotto. It's like.
Fair Verona.
It's like the Juliet Tower or the Juliet Balcony and,
yes,
risotto. Like, those
that's
are
right,
the only thing they're known for. That risotto is still good, not as good as Athens.
Whoa. Dang. And that's an Italian dish?
That's an Italian dish.
Risotto.
But top five, so I think that top five meal, that one. Honestly, the food was good. We had bangers and mash in London. Mm. That was amazing. But it was also just, like, the experience of it. We saw a lot of friends along the way.
Mm. Okay.
So it wasn't just, like, us necessarily exploring on our own. We, like, met up with people.
Oh, that's
we stayed
fun.
With, like, some family, like, met up with friends.
Mm-hmm.
In Dublin. Dublin was one of my favorite places we went to the whole trip. Ireland, amazing.
Which part of it was amazing? Like, the going, eating bangers and mash? Like, what part of Ireland was the best part?
I think...
The bar.
I love the pub. Pub scene.
Yes.
I made this joke, I think, to you of, like, I'm there for pubs, not clubs. Because, like,
yes.
Clubbing isn't my vibe. But the pub scene, amazing. I also love the accent. And yeah. I think there's something about, like, being able to understand everyone.
Yeah.
Where, like... They have this amazing accent. They have this amazing culture. But it's also, they're still speaking my language.
Right.
So I can understand. Like, there's things that I don't necessarily understand. Like, maybe, like, phrases and stuff.
A little nuanced
stuff.
But
I still, like, I could speak to them. And it wasn't like,
Right.
Because, like, we went to Greece, France, Italy. In all of those places, you're, like, trying to, like, okay, well, no, that's not how you say hello in Italian. How do I say hello in France? Oh, Greek. And, like, you're just trying to, like, kind of. Bend to their culture, which you should.
Uh-huh.
That's
hello
thing.
In Greek.
Of course.
I don't remember. In
you're already forgetting.
What'd you say?
Oh my gosh, your memories are fading.
In Greece,
she's been away too long.
So many people spoke English. Like, I never even felt the need to, like, try. Mm. Like, everyone spoke English.
Because it was so touristy, you think?
So,
or?
Yeah, so touristy. We went to the two, like, biggest tourist islands in Greece. We went to Santorini and Mykonos.
Yeah.
Like
the yogurt.
Yeah. I think
cultured.
If I'm really good, just say, like, I don't think I can, like, pinpoint five moments, top
yeah.
five.
Because I already hear a couple of them. Number one, risotto.
Number two,
number
pub.
Two,
Ireland.
Pub, Irish pub.
Yeah.
Number three, just give me, like, a highlight in every place.
What about the
highlight from every country?
Is it the Parthenon?
Yeah.
How many
Athens.
Countries did you go to?
I did. How many what?
How many countries did you go to?
I went to five.
Okay, highlight in every country. That's great.
I think a highlight for Greece
was the risotto, I hear. Or no, give me a better highlight.
I think was going to we went to the Acropolis, which is the Parthenon.
So
and
cool.
Everything.
Temple
and that
of Zeus.
Was we went at 8 a.m. in the morning because that's when it opens. It's like the coldest part of the day, and it was like 85 degrees.
Wow.
And it was just like so. There's like no one in the streets, and you really felt like you were exploring the city alone.
Wow.
Which is so cool.
Awesome.
It also is just crazy to be, like, at the birthplace of, like, democracy and,
yes.
you know, and going to the
culture, art,
yeah,
the
like,
gods.
We started making this joke of, like, older than America. You see that pebble over there?
Older than America. So true.
You see
isn't
that chair?
Crazy?
Older than America. Like, and truly. And, like, and then, so then from there we went to Italy and we did a 10-day tour of Italy, all through all the different towns. And I think my favorite of Italy, which is so hard because they were like, we went to like probably 10 towns in Italy. But I would probably be Florence. And we did this walking tour and it was a random rainstorm.
Mm.
Like, so then the streets are like flooding in Florence, like just completely random, this rainstorm. Mm. And it's like freezing cold, which is like the coldest we had been like in the 2 weeks we were there at that point. So it was so nice. We all get these brightly colored ponchos and we're like, well, we're still doing the walking tour. So we're like running through Florence and these like, they look like little colorful condoms running through Florence. We look ridiculous.
I'm sure you did.
Yeah. And like we have the little like headpiece. So this lady's like speaking in our ear about all the history.
Yes, oh, that's
just,
awesome.
Like, pouring rain and thunder and lightning. And, you know, you're seeing like the Statue of David and you're running past like she's like, oh, and this bridge is from the medieval times. And you're like, this
wow.
is insane. And then you like turn the corner and you see the Duomo. And, like, just the insane, like, I just remember literally, she's like, so you're going to see the Duomo, and it's really fascinating. And I just was like, oh! And she's exactly, that's, like, that is
what
the,
is that?
It's their cathedral.
Oh.
And it is so detailed. Like, it's just insane. They
is
use three
the one
different
that's
kinds.
Like, in the giant courtyard? What's that one?
They're all kind of in giant courtyards.
It's a good guess.
But they use three different kinds of marble, so it's just, like, insane. And it's huge. And, like, just, like, in the insane detail that went into everything. So I think Florence would probably be. And then, like, at that night, we went to Tuscany, and we had a risotto night in Tuscany.
Whoa. But you're saying you stand by the Athens risotto.
Yeah, Athens risotto is the best risotto I've had.
I mean, you've been all over Italy now, so now you can truly say.
I got risotto in
Milan. So then you jet over to France.
Then we go to France. We go to the French Alps for 5 days.
What's your top from France?
This is going to be, like, sacrilegious. People are really upset by this statement. I really liked Paris.
I think a lot of people say it's like trendy to come back and be like, oh, it was dirty and oh, touristy, and the Eiffel Tower is not that great.
I think the reality was Rome was so disgustingly dirty.
Oh, really?
That Paris was clean to me. I was like, this isn't dirty. Which, granted, we've
What
had
about the Lizzie McGuire Fountain?
Trevi.
Oh, I went to the Trevi Fountain, and that was great. We love that.
We do
that
love that.
Cool. It was packed, but, like, it was beautiful. It was breathtakingly beautiful.
Mm. So cool.
But, like, Rome was literally disgusting.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Everyone, like, kept making the joke. Sucks. They're like, Rome's great if you look, like, middle of the eye level up, if you don't look down. But I also stayed, like, in kind of, like, the cell block of Paris where it's nice.
Sure. Mm.
Like, we literally had 24 hours in Paris. So we, like, did the Louvre. We saw the Mona Lisa. We did the Eiffel Tower sparkles at night. We, like, went and, you know, tried escargot and... like, ooh, just, like, did all the, like, major things. We went on the, like, Ferris wheel.
I've heard from about Paris from, like, Olivia and Emma is that it's more, like, you can't spend more than 3 days in Paris.
Yeah,
like, you do everything in a day.
You go and see it, and then that's it.
I wouldn't recommend spending a lot of time. Yeah. And then, of course, there's, like, we went to the Paris Opera House, which we would never have known to do, except we were staying at the house of one of, like, the most prestigious ballet teachers in Paris.
Oh, dang.
Yeah, one of Kayla's hookups. I don't know. Like, she, like, it was a friend of a friend kind of vibe.
Pierre Ballet.
And they were out of town, so they literally just, like, let us stay at their pad when they were gone. But she recommended the Paris Opera House, and, like, because that's where, like, all the ballets happen and stuff. It was insane. It was gorgeous. It was, like, just crazy. It was beautiful. If you have the opportunity, it was like $9 to go.
Wow.
It was so beautiful. And it was raining there too. So then it was like, got out of the rain, hang out in this gorgeous place.
Give me one more highlight.
Because France.
I'm sure we could do an entire podcast series on this. And
I'll tell you what,
the Tafoyas, specifically my parents, have a lot of questions for you.
Love.
They are
I'm
just
so
ready to hear about your trip. Give me one more top.
Okay. So I already kind of mentioned in the beginning of, like, London, Dublin, I love. I'll give you another top from Paris.
Sure.
We spent 5 days in the French Alps, right? Staying with my friend Julia's family that, like, are in this small village that felt straight from a fairy tale. Like, all the buildings are 1300s. These people have lived, like, these families are from this village, have lived in this village for, like, 500 years.
Wow.
And it was one of the most beautiful places in the world. Like, breathtakingly beautiful in the culture, in the farmer's market in the morning where the whole town comes together.
Wow.
It was just like cobblestone roads. Literally. And like all the roofs are kind of like wonky because they were built by hand and they were thatched hundreds of years ago.
Wow.
And it was just like this feeling of like these people live their whole lives here and they don't really want for anything because they are just like happy to be here. Like the kids running through the street playing, they have like drinking fountains everywhere and not like our drinking fountains, just like spigots of water that are like good for drinking everywhere because it's like comes down straight from the mountain from the Alps. And the kids like playing in the fountains in the street, having like water fights and just like there's just like a joy of life there.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Do you find yourself tripping on the cobblestone?
No, I was pretty good.
No streets of cobblestone.
I feel like I'd literally be like hitting my toe and be like, oh.
Dublin was worse. Dublin was like more like true cobblestone.
Uh-huh.
And that one I was kind of like, oh.
Well, you've got me sold. I've booked our passport appointment. Yeah. I'm locking it in. I need to get myself to Europe. Just, you know.
John, do you have a passport?
Dip myself in the culture.
Yeah. Yeah, I have a passport. I went to Guatemala a couple years ago and had to get it then.
Oh,
okay. So what the podcast takes on Europe or something.
I think, guys, I seriously, the whole time I was in Ireland, I was like, man, this would be so fun with you guys.
Oh,
this would be so fun
I would
with
love,
you guys.
I'd love to get there.
We would kill Ireland. Not kill for real.
No,
real
of course
killing.
Not.
Kill? Come on.
There's something about, you know, just dipping yourself in a different culture that is just awesome. And this week, a not so awesome dipping into a different culture happened for a one Matt Healy of 1975.
Yeah, what happened?
So this is kind of crazy. The 1975 played at a festival in Malaysia called the Good Times Festival. Big, you know, music festival, kind of like Coachella, whatever. And they were the headliner for the Friday of the rest of this weekend of music. But the kind of like weird, tricky thing is Malaysia is one of these countries that has a strict ban on LGBTQ people. Can't be gay. It's illegal to be gay. The culture is, it's like literally illegal. And so,
Matt Healy's bi too.
Now, whether or not he knew this, Matt Healy goes on this rant on stage about how wrong it is that the government allows this, that it's wrong because they're all bigots. And he goes on this long rant, shuts down the festival and cancels it for the rest of the weekend. Malaysia does.
Ah.
Because of his outspokenness. And he was kind
Don't
of saying
mess with
like
Malaysia, you know what I'm saying?
He was saying, you know, I was short-sighted to even have booked, like, why would they even let us book this tour? He was saying this, all of this on microphone. Why would they even let us book this show? They know like how I feel about this, like goes on this long rant. And yeah, so the discourse now is people are saying, well, yeah, you've kind of ruined this for everyone over in Malaysia. Like they, you know, people that, because obviously that doesn't mean there's not gay people in Malaysia, right? And they're saying, hey, we, you know, we're going to get now like bombarded by the government because they're going to take, you know, retaliate for this thing that happened.
Sure.
And you've kind of ruined it. But obviously, you know, we as Americans, well, he's not American. But I will say we as Western civilizations have this idea of like we can say whatever we want, we can do whatever we want.
We live in this democracy.
He's British, yes.
Yeah.
So kind of crazy, kind of nuts.
Do you think the government is going to go hard on it or just be like, we canceled the festival, whatever?
I think they're already hard on it. I could see, like, I mean, I don't know if they're a, someone will have to fact check me, if they're like a totalitarian type of government or if it's more like, you know, like culture is part of the government and it's like they claim to be democratic or whatever, but I don't know. I could see it going badly for the people like that actually live there, but
whenever I think of Malaysia, I think of circa 2013, 2014.
Okay.
When Malaysia airplane disappeared.
Yes. That's pretty much the extent of your Malaysian knowledge.
That is my Malaysian knowledge.
I love that so much.
I'm going to be honest.
You're that Malaysian airplane.
I don't know much about Malaysia either.
Representative democracy.
So okay. Us. The same as us.
But I mean, I guess the.
But it's kind of like the Electoral College here. Like they don't necessarily have to vote representing that. Like they should.
Right. Right.
That's why they're there. But
democracy.
Kind of interesting.
Air quotes. What do you think, John?
I mean, I think, yes, I see your point. I see you and probably a lot of point of view of like this could be potentially dangerous and toxic for the political environment there. But I also think if it's a representative democracy, you know, this might spark a conversation there just purely because, as we know, governmental, you know, these issues always pique the government's you know, kind of interest when it comes about money. Like Matt Healy's tour would have brought in a lot of commerce.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying? And,
sure.
And whether or not the government sees that, you know, losing that as like a big deficit. And also now the government has to think forward and go, no artists are going to come here because we've taken this hard stance on something that the rest of the world, most of the rest of the world is open to, you know, maybe might change something for you.
It's so funny as a country because it's like, I look back at like, okay, like slavery, right?
Sure.
America was one of like the last countries in the world to truly be like, yeah, you know what? Slavery, bad.
Yeah, totally.
Like, and everyone else is like, yeah, bro, we'd been done with that for a while. And here's like LGBTQ, you know, rights. And like, let's be real, America really didn't get behind that until like not long ago.
Sure.
Sure.
Like,
I think broad strokes were definitely on the forefront of like, accepting it and like and certainly
as far as legal rights goes, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like obviously there's a cultural stuff in America that we're
still working through. Yeah.
But you know, you can in America right now, you can get married to whoever you want.
Right.
I think Hollywood has a big to do about that.
Uh-huh.
I feel like it's because since we have, like, Hollywood, and it's like, this is where the biggest movies and TV shows in the world are.
Sure.
Where other countries, like, yeah, there's, like, Bollywood, but that's, like, fully cultural difference. Sure. Yeah.
So what do you mean, like, on a
Hollywood is the reason that we're so on the forefront on this issue, you think?
I think so. Because we get out there more of, like...
Yeah, I think of, like, China and how, like, certain movies will get banned in China, or they'll get, like, seriously, like, suppressed in China, or some movies do really well in China, and how certain, like, movie houses, production companies will kind of bend certain things to more, like... serve like a Chinese audience because they know that means okay more money like coming in from a worldwide perspective, just not so much a I don't know what the difference would be, but you could speculate. But it kind of is a similar thing, I think. Like if you're going to Malaysia to be part of this festival, that's probably not the best place for your like platform to be served that way, because it's not, you're not in the UK, you're not in the US where people's, you can like speak of ideas and certain things and have no repercussions for it. So it's kind of like,
It is definitely irresponsible.
Whether or not that's a good thing is kind of, we could go back and forth about
point. As we know, like an artist like, music artists and stuff like that tour the world, like, Their responsibility is kind of with their fan base, you know what I'm saying? And so, like, that is irresponsible of Matt Healy to go, like, I'm going to take this political stand and ruin this whole weekend that was supposed to be for my fans, all because, like, and again, maybe he thinks he was doing something good by, potentially starting a conversation, but really those people are out their experience.
The people
sucks.
Who are gay in that country felt connected somehow.
Maybe, right. Yeah.
Then I totally. Think 75 they're- need to ditch Matt Healy.
He is the 1975. What do you mean?
I mean, he's just, if I was part of his band, I'd be so freaking done with him.
Mm.
I'm like, you keep on doing this crap that ruins the rest of the band.
Right. Don't they kind of play on it though? Like, isn't the one where he goes to say something controversial and they start a song or something?
That's like a bit, for sure.
He'll grab a security guard and kiss
them. But they've kind of embraced that part of him, right?
Yes, where he's kind of playing this part of like the drunken fool, right? Like where he say anything and do anything, and that's kind of this like persona he's created.
Yeah. But at some point, the method acting is no longer acting. Like, you're now embodying that.
I'd certainly say...
disaster.
It went too far in this situation.
Yeah.
But it's kind of it's a tricky thing because, if you look at other countries similar to, maybe not similar to that, but like North Korea is like a strict, like totalitarian regime. Like, do I support North Korea? Like, no. But would I go into North Korea and be like, we need, like,
you need to change.
Rise up against your government. Like, that's, you catch a bullet so quickly doing
I
that
just
way.
Speaking of North Korea. I just saw a whole article that a U.S. soldier was in South Korea, was getting extradited back to the U.S. for assault charges, and he ran into North Korea. He crossed war zone or whatever, and ran into North Korea.
The demilitarized zone.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Crazy.
It seemed to me, they interviewed like all of his people around him, and they were like, we don't know why he did it. He just like...
Everyone's like, we don't know why
it seems like
that.
An intrusive
he
thought
just
came
to get
on.
Out of charges.
And he's like, he's like, wouldn't it be crazy if I just ran across right now? I'll just do it.
And there's like footage of it, of him running. And everyone's like...
What? Where's he go?
I saw this thing that... I think it's in South Korea, that there's like a mock North Korea for like those who want to see... Some guy posted a TikTok of like... This is a like mock makeup of North Korea, and like how it would be if you ever went there, and
that way people don't actually
kind of interesting,
go.
Right?
I mean, over there it's way more like complex than in our minds. It's like, oh, North Korea is totalitarian, South Korea is free. Like, why would you ever want to? But it's kind of like the people that live there near the border are like kind of the similar thing that happened in like India. It's like, oh, okay, like I'm from Korea, like my family's from this part of the country, but I'm from here. Like,
but now it's north and
but
south.
Now it's north and south. Like,
so who am
okay,
I?
Maybe I should go.
So
and
who am I?
Maybe I should rely on my government. Maybe they do have the best intentions for me, and it's like not as black
government,
and white.
Government is a very great area. And I feel like if we didn't know that before, we recently saw Oppenheimer.
Nice transition, Annie.
I almost went with the band content.
I was going to do the censoring because in the Philippines, they
that's what I was
going
to do. But go ahead. Do your thing.
They didn't come out with Barbie in the Philippines?
Yeah.
They did now, but it's because that map.
I just looked it up.
The map in the movie, there's a line where for some, it says
and Vietnam. Is that true?
Like China owns the South China Sea when the Philippines is actually their territory. But on that fake little map, there's a dotted line.
And yeah, they're called the nine dashes.
Yes.
And that's like something that they, that, like in world maps, is something that's been going on for a long time.
But then literally
China
the
tries
makers
to claim
of Barbie.
The sea and call it the South China Sea, but it's really not. And those countries all are kind of battling over that.
Wow.
But then you go back to the map and everything's wrong.
And the Barbie producer's like, we just made like a kid's drawing map. Like we didn't, like it wasn't that serious.
We weren't trying to make
that's
it.
That's crazy.
Yeah, it was banned in Vietnam and the Philippines. Yeah. I just looked. Yeah.
But they ended up blurring out that line and they did come
that's
out with
so
movie.
Funny
that is crazy.
Well, if you're following this show and if you're on social media, TikTok, anything at all this weekend, you know that we did it. We saw the movies Oppenheimer and Barbie back to back. Barbenheimer,
Oppenbarb. We saw Oppenbarb.
We did. We watched Oppenbarbie,
which honestly I don't know how you could do it the other way.
Yeah. Yep.
Oppenheimer is such a heavy movie.
Yeah.
And Barbie was exactly what I needed to feel okay. I can't imagine because I feel like Barbie still has if you're watching this, you haven't seen the movies.
Barbie. Let's go Barbie.
Just go ahead, pause
major
it,
spoiler,
come back, watch the movies.
Major spoiler alert for both Oppenheimer
and
Barbie.
Yeah, because we did kind of see them the day they came out. Yeah. So there's a really good chance that we're spoiling something for you.
Yeah, so spoiler alert now. And
skip to this timestamp.
Yeah. Anyway, so Barbie kind of leaves you with a tinge of sadness still of man, it really is so hard in this world.
But at least you laughed.
Yep. At least you laughed. And Oppenheimer leaves you with that same tinge of sadness, but with zero hope.
Lingering.
So let's start with Oppenheimer because that's the order we watched him in. What'd you guys think of the movie?
We need a stopwatch. I could talk about it for hours.
Just your top three of Oppenheimer.
Oh, God. Well, first for
I mean, because we could truly watch. We could do a whole episode on either one of the movies by themselves.
If you haven't seen it, you don't know what the concept is.
Yes,
J. Robert Oppenheimer was basically the person in charge of the atomic bomb creation in the Manhattan Project and the secret town where
Trinity.
It was made in Los Alamos and. He was the physicist, behind the science
quantum
that kind of pushed it, and he ran the team. So it's about his life and the bombing and the creation of the bomb
and the fallout.
Great
fallout.
Great summary.
I think we should maybe start with the theme that struck you the most.
Oh, okay.
Because then we're not diving into all the little theories.
Yes, totally.
What was the part the theme or the area of the movie that was you've kind of been thinking about, because there's really kind of one for me, but do you have
first of all, love the movie. I think, the story and something I found out later on is the screenplay for this movie was written in first person. So it wasn't,
that's right.
It wasn't Oppenheimer walked to the window. It's I walked towards the window. I talked to this person and I really think
a diary.
What's funny is I don't know if I could have pinpointed that, but you feel this sense of really being in this guy's head. Especially there's this opening sequence where he's doing, his physics work and he's studying and he's gaining all this information. And the music is just super high strung and it's really fast little violin parts and everything. And it's super kind of swelling to this point where he's this tenured professor now at Berkeley. And I just I thought every element of his character, we just really got this innate sense of how he was feeling about certain things, how he how he reacted to making this discovery. I really, one part of the movie that I really liked is when he is kind of cheering everybody on. They successfully do it. They do the bomb test and it they end up dropping it on Japan and everybody's cheering, but there's this moment where he kind of stops and it's quiet and the background behind him is shaking.
Yeah.
And I thought that was just one of the most compelling parts of the movie.
All
you
the
can,
practical
it
effects.
Felt so from that point of the movie on, I was just so on edge. Like, I was like, I could not relax at all. Like, it was so unhinged and everything like that. I just, I felt something.
I read that it ended up the movie, because half of the movie's in color, and like I would say maybe a quarter of it was in black and white.
Sure. Yeah.
And it's, I guess it ended up being all the colored parts were supposed to be his first person, and the black and white were supposed to be outside of him.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which, and you see that he's in black and white.
No one does that in another movie where he like takes two timelines, one in black and white, one in color. And the color was actually a reverse timeline mixed in with the black and white, which was a chronologically correct timeline. And it was like, that's what made the movie so confusing, but it was like such an artistic thing that he does. So he uses black and white and I guess in color pretty frequently in his film. So kind
of cool.
It was a hard movie for me to watch.
Yeah, it was rough.
I ended up actually crying multiple times in the movie, just because like I think the biggest theme that I kind of got out of it was just turmoil. Mm-hmm. Like in the beginning, you see like just his mental turmoil where he almost had so much knowledge that he didn't know what to do with it, and then like this the turmoil that ended up being his life and his like personal life and his marriage, and then you know there's the success of like, okay, well now I'm gonna put all my efforts towards building this thing and like creating this team and working with the government, and that like at one point he's like wearing the like a general's coat and one of the other scientists is like, you need to take that off, like you're a scientist, and he's like, no, they want us to enlist, he's like, take it off, you look ridiculous. It's just like he doesn't have an identity in this, that turmoil. And I think like what you're talking about, Ryan, is like the moment that they get word that the bomb has been dropped, it successfully landed, quote unquote, successfully landed in Japan. Like it's that almost that realization of like, oh, a whole different kind of turmoil has happened. Like at one point in the movie, they dropped the estimate of deaths that they think the bomb will have. And it's 20,000. And then the death toll from the bombs is closer to 250,000.
Crazy.
Wait, yeah, because they didn't like take into account the days
the
after.
The fallout, yeah.
And they couldn't. They couldn't have known. They literally were creating the science as they went. Like, And there was like that moment at the very end of the movie where he's talking to Albert Einstein. Because there's like a section of math where they don't know if this bomb will ignite the atmosphere, and then it will be basically a series of atomic bombs within all of the air until the whole world's destroyed. And they like take it to Albert Einstein to check the math. And he makes a comment at the very end of like, I think I destroyed the world.
Still did, even if you didn't, technically.
Yeah.
And he did.
Just like the casual talking about like such destruction and what does end up becoming like
when they were choosing the cities in Japan. Oh my God.
It's crazy. Yeah. They're like,
oh, we can't do Kyoto because I went on my honeymoon there.
Well, it's cultural significance too. They're like, it's too culturally significant to the country. Yeah.
It's like, but fuck these other two cities.
Literally.
So I personally have been to Los Alamos.
Really? Yeah.
Several times, apparently.
Yeah, my parents took us there multiple times.
Missed something on the first time, or?
How far away is that?
It's in New Mexico.
New Mexico.
Yeah, how far away is that?
It's like,
see, let's look it up.
Two states away. So like we're in California, right?
A day's drive.
You know where Arizona is,
so
right?
So we're going to Utah.
One state over.
How far away is it from Utah?
No, different direction.
Oh, different. It'd be like we'd have to cross over.
Dang it.
Yeah, I know. I know. I thought about that.
It's interesting. What's funny is like, it's not funny. What's hard about it is, it's now like this cultural landmark of like our success story, but there's like no success in it.
Like sure, it was a success that you got the bomb right there.
Yeah. And
sure.
And it's just so crazy because like they set up like what the houses were like in this town, and in the history behind it's interesting because it was literally like 7 years practically.
Yeah.
Like when all is said and done, when they finally kind of shut it down of like this secret town that people 3 miles away didn't know existed.
So crazy.
And they're like, what do you mean? There's a whole town out there? What are you talking about? And now they've kept it as this landmark. And it's like, this is just crazy because like there's so much pain and destruction. And like these people dedicate, like you see the unraveling in Oppenheimer of his wife.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it's like she sacrificed a lot too.
Do you Do they have marked off the actual site? Oh, yeah, they do, where the bomb did go off.
Yeah, they do.
Because there's a guy on TikTok who said that, because they how they said how, like, the sand particles, like, can mesh together and create, like, a gem or, like, glass. Some kind of and glass and stone.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
There was a guy on TikTok who said that there is something called, like, in the early days when people were able to go and check it out,
yeah. mm-hmm.
they were finding these, like, glittery stones, and they ended up calling them Trinity stones.
Okay.
And they are now illegal to pick there because of the radiation, who knows, whatever. But there is, like, less than a mile from Los Alamos is a little shop where it's not illegal to buy or collect any of them before, like, 1980 or something.
So hilarious.
And they sell them. And if you keep them, like, in their packaging and, like, behind this plastic glass and stuff, it's not enough radiation to do anything. Isn't that crazy?
I think the whole concept is crazy. And kind of what Annie's talking about, like, that we just did this thing. We basically, like, broke science.
Yeah.
We
yeah.
broke, like, nature to create this thing that all said and done killed, you know, it's like 100 9/11s, right?
So
we lost,
know,
like, 2,000 people on 9/11, 2,500.
Any of this?
What, Nagasaki? Hiroshima?
No, I knew about that, but I didn't know
the Trinity.
Yes.
I didn't know, like, who Robert J. Oppenheimer was, uh-huh. whatever, all this stuff. And then watching the movie,
the J stands for Julius, like Julius Caesar.
Oh. When watching the movie, nerd. I was like, oh, okay, this makes sense. Nerd. He's Jewish, and uh-huh. his people are being murdered by Hitler.
Uh-huh.
Of course, he wants to, like, stop this, all this stuff. And then I just got so sad when it was like, yep, Hitler's dead, like, missed the mark. And then at the end when he's like, if only we got the Germans.
Yeah.
Wah, wah.
And, like, he completely lost track of. And, yes. and I think that speaks to the entire story is, like, they really lost track of what it was all about. And it became more about the doing.
Because it was the race before the
making
Nazis
of this bomb. Yeah.
And well, then it was like, well, the Nazis never got it because they just fizzled out.
And it wasn't even necessarily the Nazis because they flew over Russia and picked up radiation signals. So they're like, the Russians are making one mm-hmm. of these bombs. Where it was like, well, Russia was an ally at the end of the war with us.
Yeah.
Which obviously, like, now it's not necessarily that same story. And mm-hmm. then
and even years later, we had the whole Cold War.
Well, and this is what sparked it, was yeah. this, like, race to arms. And the reality is, like, they, like, at the end of the movie is this, like, kind of, like, or it's not really end, it's, like, throughout it. It's the conversation between Oppenheimer and, like, he's getting, like, interrogated for his role. Mm-hmm. He's, like, they're trying to take away his security clearance.
Yeah.
And
mark that he's a communist.
Yeah, and say that he's a communist.
Yep.
And they're, like, well, why didn't you stop it? Which you see in the movie, like, multiple people tell him not to make this bomb.
Mm-hmm.
That, like, it's going to destroy the world one way or another. Like, don't do it. And he basically was like, I didn't know we were going to use it.
It's crazy.
That's like, so crazy because it's like, yeah, this is your scientific like acknowledgement. You did this. And then, of course, the government is going to take it from you.
Yeah.
Like, duh.
The biggest theme out of it, and mm-hmm. this is why it really was hard for me to watch, because, like, studying government and studying, devoting so much of my life and brain power to politics and to this game, which is, like, the end of the day, it's a game,
right?
And the whole idea is America's argument is, like, we're gonna do this to help save people from unjust acts from their government. And they never drop the bombs on government buildings. They never just round up the government and free the people who are oppressed by them. It's like we make the most insane unjust acts to what scare them. And that's what they literally say. They said, we're gonna drop two. We're going to drop one to show them we have it, and two to show them that we're going to keep doing it until they surrender.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's not saving anyone. You're just killing, you know, innocent people for no reason.
Arguably one of the biggest tragedies.
Was this before or after Pearl Harbor?
It was way after. Pearl Harbor was
So they had a reason. Oh, yeah, okay.
Pearl Harbor was the catalyst of all this, right? Yeah.
Well, certainly of us entering the war.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Kind of a, that's
Pearl Harbor
its,
was like,
its own podcast.
3 years old.
John, give us a big takeaway. We're going to go a little long because we still want to talk about Barbie.
Yes.
But John, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, the theme that I keep going back to is, like, the theoretical versus practical. Like, that was kind of the theme throughout the whole movie is Oppenheimer was like, he was really good at theorizing and he wasn't good at practical. Like you see that like even in the beginning, like he was terrible at like actual labs mm-hmm. because he just like couldn't, like he wasn't good with actually building something like that. But, and I thought like that was so true too, because like his mind was racing to finish this because he's like, in theory it should work. And we've done all the, you know, we have to get there. Mm-hmm. And then as soon as, in the movie, I mean, obviously, as you'll see, like the bomb drops and in the explosion, you can kind of see it in his eyes, like, oh, like he's seeing what the practicality of this theory that he's been like kind of pushing and like making, trying to make happen. And that was just terrifying. I thought like that was the saddest part, is he just is like Annie said, he's really like, he was always like too smart for his own good. And then mm-hmm. he sees like, oh, I've crossed the line and didn't even know I was crossing mm-hmm. it, because I was like, so he was so obsessed with like getting it done and making the math work and making everything make sense. And then when it like, you see it, he sees it in real life, he's like, oh no, I am the angel death. Like yeah. I've now created something that I wish I could take back, but the math is already there mm-hmm. and it's already become a reality. And it's like the dangers of science almost.
Right. Yeah, everything is safe as a theory.
Kind of
yeah.
true about his love life too, right? He has kind of this mistress and this wife, and this mistress is very like wishy-washy, this mm-hmm. communist woman that's like, oh, I love you and I need you when I need you, but not like
all the time.
And then his ends up marrying this woman, his wife, the mother of his yeah. children, that's kind of like, hey, you need to cut your shit and like be present in this marriage and in your life, or you're not gonna.
Yeah.
You Florence know. Pugh's character was actually a 19-year-old college student. I watched Yeesh. A whole TikTok about this lady. Yeah.
Her and she was living at home with her parents. Oh,
so
happened.
Crazy.
It's a huge story, and highly recommend yeah. seeing it. Yeah.
And then
let's
you're depressed,
just
and then you go to Barbie.
Let's yeah. let's briefly talk about Barbie as we wrap up for the day here.
Barbie.
Wow. So an equally, I'd argue, as big of a movie. I
honestly,
think such a great
so
and a cultural, you know, piece
so great.
Says a lot about feminism.
I want to go get a Barbie.
Doesn't it make you want to just bust out the Barbie?
I literally tell their commercializing of Barbie in this giant commercial that they call the Barbie movie.
Yep.
Genius.
Yes.
Can you believe that?
I think my parents got rid of most of my Barbie. They like gave them to like neighbors, like young, like little girl neighbors.
Do you
like,
going to go ask for them back? Or
I'm going to go search my parents'
yeah,
house.
That's
I
a good
and
call.
See if they're back.
That's
see
a good
if
call.
I
so, like you gave it to his
see if I have a couple.
Tina doesn't get rid of anything.
So
she's
good.
Got Barbies.
Yeah.
So,
they've got to
so
be somewhere.
John, we'll start
so
with
good.
You on this one because you got to and Oppenheimer.
Yeah, I mean, I thought similarly, like, in the sense that the whole movie kind of felt gimmicky until the end.
Uh-huh.
Like, it was obviously, there's a big play on the patriarchy, which I think is relevant, but it was just, like, so blatantly, like, you
on
know,
the nose.
It was kind of, like, goofy, you know? And like I felt like they were playing it goofy. And uh-huh. maybe because it was, like, you know, satire in the way that it was supposed to maybe be funny, but it's obviously still serious.
Yeah.
But there was this ending scene between like the creator of Barbie and then Barbie, Margot Robbie. And I thought that kind of saved the movie for me, because it was like this, again, as we know, Mattel is kind of out to make money and they've commercialized Barbie out the wazoo. But
for sure.
I do feel like some, like that scene was kind of like, oh, this was like the intention of Barbie, and
yeah.
at its core, it was like Barbie was always supposed to empower little girls to make them believe they can do whatever they want to do.
Yes.
Way, which is why you have the variation of Barbie, which is why you have all the crazy versions of Barbie, mm-hmm. right? But at its core, like I think the creator of Barbie, like said, that kind of moment kind of not saved the movie, but it made it so much better for me, because I felt like the patriarchy thing, I was like, this
totally.
Is like, this is, it's just like so in your face. You're like,
yeah.
okay, like I get it, but also like, do we need a movie? But then like I said, that scene kind of like fully like
yeah.
Made it a full circle for me. And I was yeah. like, and I'll be honest, I in the theater, we were sitting in the back and I could literally like hear like people crying, like,
yeah.
like girls by us crying. And I thought, how important is this movie and even this scene
mm-hmm.
To remind us, you know, that we should be thinking of women and ally and being an ally to women, you know, as men,
yeah.
I should say, you know what
Agreed.
I'm saying? Because even though we think that we live in a world, which we obviously know isn't true, we think we might live in a world that's potentially equal between men and women. You
sure.
know what I'm saying? There is still so much that has to be done and that needs to be repaired and that needs to be equalized. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Obviously pay and things like that. But that was just such a reminder for me as a man, because it was like, I live in a world that largely, you know, it favors me.
Yeah.
And it opened my eyes to like, oh, I need to do more. I need to be like more open to supporting women in that sense.
But I think Ryan Gosling's character really spoke into that too. Like, he on the outset is like this kind of comic relief, like goofy guy, right? In a world where like all the women are in charge, like the guys kind of fall to the wayside, and like, but then he comes to the real world and realizes like, oh, like patriarchy is awesome. Like, men do have power, and like kind of his coming to terms with that, I think it really speaks to like, it's not just women that get like that are suffering from the society we live in, right? Yeah. Like, well, men are also dealing with the fact that like, we also have a role that we are supposed to play in this patriarchy, and how you're not born with that. It's kind of like this kid becoming a man. Like, nobody's born thinking that like, oh, men are better than women. Like, it's a thing that we learn from society and from, you know,
what I thought other was men. So crazy about that was how in the beginning we don't get to see where the Kens live. I wanted to see that so badly.
They didn't live anywhere. He lived on the beach.
Even though all the Barbies had all the roles, you never saw Kens like serving at their feet,
uh-huh.
like all this stuff. And then when Ken brings the patriarchy in, it's like suddenly the like women are the servants.
Somebody has to serve somebody else.
I
will say,
I think that like, because okay, so conservatives are really upset about Barbie. It's like this shocking whole wave of like, they're like, they're just, it's too woke, and they're saying the patriarchy and men are bad and all stuff, which I don't think is what they're saying.
Uh-huh. I know.
Like, Ryan Gosling, I
watched
a bunch of...
They were just showing how silly it was.
Well, I think even beyond that, I think there's, like, Ryan Gosling said that he didn't want to play Ken for a long time because he's, like, there's a complexity about this, and I didn't want to ruin it.
Mm-hmm.
And Margot Robbie had to promise to give him a present every single day on set.
Did you see why he said yes?
Because of the Ken on
his daughter's Ken doll.
And it was face down in the dirt next to a squished lemon. And he took a picture and sent it to Greta Gerwig and was like, I will be your Ken. His story needs to be told.
That is hilarious.
But I think there's like, there's a true element where it's like, he had no purpose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then he gets brought into the quote unquote real world, where he's like, oh yeah, you're supposed to be powerful, you're supposed to do all this stuff. And he's like, oh, this is great. And he brings it back and it's chaos because like he had no structure and no one telling him like how to do it or what to do. And then at the end, and I saw people get mad because like Ken basically, spoilers, Ken takes over Barbie Land. He brings the patriarchy, ruins Barbie Land, makes it Ken World.
Gets
or whatever.
Obsessed with horses.
Yeah, thinks the patriarchy has something to do with horses. Which turns out that one of the books on horses that he like holds up, he's like, you caught me reading, was one of the gifts that Margot Robbie gave him. And he read the whole thing and he's like, now like, I'm so into horses. He's like so interested
it
by this
became
horse
part
book.
Of the story.
Yeah. And he said he wants to turn it into a movie, and Margot Robbie starts talking about it in an interview, and he's like, shut up. That's my next movie. Nope. Stop talking about it. Like, he's like, gonna make this horse movie.
I think the conservative camp getting upset is probably, it's part of the experience, right? Yeah. I mean, like, there's some really true facts getting thrown around this movie, some actual, like, and to John's point, it was super on the nose. I mean, there's this whole monologue that America Ferrera has that's kind of, like, synthesizing all of
what it's like to be a woman.
Again, true things, like, and we'll never, like, understand what it means to be a woman, but, like, what was my point? But the like, if you're getting offended by that as somebody that's like keep that, you know, like you shouldn't be saying things like that. It's like, okay, you're obviously either benefiting from it or you're so like you missed the whole point.
Yeah.
Like you're so blind to the fact that it's not about being woke. It's about like telling authentic stories about women that everybody, all women can relate to. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
there's a scene where Barbie apologizes to Ken in the throes of him taking her world.
Yep.
And I think, like, people are getting mad about it because they're like, Ken doesn't apologize for literally destroying her house and bringing a patriarchy to Barbie Land and making all her friends into, like, waitresses.
Uh-huh.
But I think there's a truth behind, like, but he, like, the whole point is, like, he didn't know anything else.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, and it was, like, this concept of, like, he was never given the attention and never given the time and never, yep. you know, like, and he didn't, like, he just, like, didn't know what to do. And he even admits, he's like, once I found out the patriarchy really didn't have anything to do with horses, I kind of got bored. And it's like, he was, like, same. So lost at the same time. Mm-hmm. And, like, and I think that plays so well for, like, men are lost and told that, like, they just have to, like, keep it together because they're leaders and they're men. And girls are like, you can't be lost. You have to kid it. You have to be the stewardess. Yeah. You have to be, you know, President Barbie. You have to be Judge Barbie. You have to be Scientist Barbie. Like, you just have to keep it together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you don't get to be lost.
Kind of a shorter element of the story, I thought, was like, but equally as impactful. I love the storyline of the mom and the daughter, like, understanding each other. Yeah. Like, the daughter realized, like, oh, it's not just, like, my mom, like, doing weird stuff and, like, being a mom. It's like she, at one point, was a little girl, too. Yeah. Like, she also loved to play with Barbies. Like, it's not such a separation of, like, you know, from that, you know?
Yeah, I thought it was an incredibly impactful movie. I think it will be it's like societal and cultural impact will kind of probably transcend for a while, I think.
Yeah. And also the writing, such good like one liners.
So funny.
Yes. So good.
Well, that was great because all the best movies have like really funny moments and then it kind of are backed with this really important message, you know. Uh-huh. And I thought that was beautifully done in this movie where it was like there's a lot of clickbaity like. Funny clips like that, like the trailer, I feel like didn't even reveal half the funny moments. No. You know what I'm saying?
Which is the best.
Which
it's
is great. We love it.
The funny moments, and you're like, well, that sucked.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I thought it was hilarious.
I heard a friend of mine said, which again is it's not a. It, I don't know that it's a huge big deal, but they're like, she went and saw it, and she's like, I loved it. She's like, the message was like so. Like beautiful, and she's like, but it's like I couldn't take my little. I wish I could take my little daughter to it, which I thought that's kind of a mere miss, but you know,
I think it's the age needs to be where like
sure
where it can go over their heads.
That's a good idea,
and it can't be too old, where they are understanding a couple adult jokes,
because
in reality, it's just a great colorful. Fun. Like, it's a dance number.
That's what I was thinking about. It definitely markets as like a little kid's movie. Like it was so like bright. Not obviously, funny. Obviously, well, if Barbie, you watched like, it, you know, maybe you would obviously.
Right.
I think there's a whole plethora of parents who are bringing their little kids to this realizing, it's not a children's movie.
They said vagina.
It's PG-13. So
yeah, I think
that's the first thing I said when we got in the theater. I was like, what is this rated? Because I was like, I think I assumed it was an adult movie, and then when we started like. I started to think about it, like maybe it's a kids movie. And
I thought it was going to be R-rated. I thought
they wrote it.
It should have been R-rated. I wrote it.
I liked how they wrote it for the Barbies to be aware of what they're doing. Like they're aware that nothing is coming out of that cup. They're aware that they're not taking real showers.
So funny.
Like it's so funny. So and then I read or I saw an interview with Will Ferrell where he literally says like, when I first read the script, I don't think the Mattel... like CEO or writers even read it.
They just said, go ahead. Because it fully dunks on Mattel.
Like, yeah, he was like, my role as the CEO is pretty crazy. And I feel like they didn't read it.
Guaranteed.
Oh, yeah. There's no way. They're just like, it's a win-win for Mattel, though. Go for it. Yeah.
I could literally hear, like, when we were done, I could hear people talking, like, oh my gosh! I totally forgot about that Barbie. Like, know they're going home. They're gonna
Karen
eBay
and I
it.
Like, the Midge Barbie. Oh my god! The Midge Barbie. Her pregnant belly, and then the baby tucked inside.
Yeah, I like the one. I really wish they had the Rapunzel Barbie with the string hair. Yeah, you that was my favorite Barbie.
I like the one where you twist the arm and the boobs grow.
Yeah,
no, it was lifting the arm.
My mom literally talked about she had that Barbie. Yeah. She's like, oh yeah, it was great.
I loved all the Easter eggs. In it, if you look at like articles now, but the old lady on the bench who she's like, you're so beautiful, and she goes, I know, that's Barbara Handel, that is Barbie, that was Ruth's daughter.
Yeah. That was
Ruth
her?
Is dead.
Yeah,
wow,
a long time ago. That is Ruth's daughter Barbara.
It's Ruth's
that she
daughter Barbie.
Oh, yeah. So
I know.
Sweet. Why didn't
sweet?
She should have played the? Well, I guess Rita Wilson.
She was really old,
untouchable. So
she's pretty old.
Guys, two gigantic movies. I will say, the movies are back.
They're back.
Okay.
Longer episode for
And
you.
I feel, here
it's
you go.
It's Barbenheimer.
It's Barbenheimer. And you know what?
We were at the movies for 7 hours. They can sit and listen to our podcast.
I have a feeling we'll be talking about those movies for a long time. Yeah. They'll definitely be going
cultural
down in history.
Icons.
Mm-hmm. And look, the free episode is a little bit longer this week. And that's because happy lip sync week. We're going to be talking about lip sync on the post show. Get stoked for that.
Rest in peace, Tony Bennett.
We didn't even talk about Tony.
Talk about him on the post show.
Tony. We'll talk about it on the post show. Folks, we want to thank our Patreon supporters as well as Texas Roadhouse.
Yes.
Hey, if you want to watch that post show, why don't you just drop a little $4 in the bucket this month? Forgo like one cup of coffee. Not even. Half a cup of coffee. And just check out the post show. It's going to be wacky, unfiltered, raw podcasting. On the couch, as always, Kara Tavoya, Annie the Scoves Goldman. I'm Ryan.
I'm John.
And we'll see you next week on What the Podcast?
I was really hoping for a Ken voice.
I don't know what that is. I'm Podcaster Barbie.
Barbie.
Ooh, that you're good at that.